and good works in order to stir up love and good works. Heavenly Father, we open your words for review. We ask, dear Lord, that you'll speak to us through them, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Paul, who we believe is the writer of the book of Hebrews, according to verse 23, tells us to hold on to something. Hold fast the confession of our hope, or the confession of our faith. What does that mean? Anyone who studied, reviewing, what do you think that means? To hold fast the confession of faith, the confession of hope. The mic is coming. Brother Price has it.
So we talk all the time about the blessed hope.
Yeah, the blessed hope.
So that hope we cherish in our hearts is the hope of Jesus' soon return. And the faith we have is that God is with us. He is helping us. He is faithful to his word. And so we can trust him even when everything around us says, let go. So the apostle is encouraging us to hold on to that faith, that hope, because not only will it buoy our spirits as we go through life's challenges, but it will see us through to the day of Jesus' appearing.
All right, so hold fast to that faith. What is faith? One of our guests is seeking to answer. Right here, Brother Price. What is faith?
The substance of all things.
The substance of all things. Anyone else? Right at the back. The substance of all things. Hold fast to the hope, the faith, the substance of all things. Sister Wrangling, and then there's a young lady right before us.
Faith.
Yes.
Is having confidence and trust in what you don't see.
Mm-hmm.
We can't see God, can we? We do not see Jesus. But he's all around us in everything that we do. Paul said, in him we move and have our being. So when we hold on to him, we have consistent faith in Jesus Christ.
All right. All right. One more. What is faith? What is hope? Why
faith.
Hold on?
Faith is unfaltering belief that... It's the unfaltering belief in a single entity, a supreme being. You understand that no matter what, everything will work out well. You just have to believe, right? So it doesn't matter what you're going through right now. Just believe in God. He will see you through that. And it doesn't matter if you cannot see the end. Just hold on to God, and he will lead you through it. You have to believe that he will lead you through it.
So there are three words that are dominating. One more answer as you come to the front right here. There are three words that are dominating. There's hope. There is trust, there is faith, there is belief. Oh, there's more than three. There's confidence, there is substance. All right.
Yes, Pastor, what I would want to say, all right, traveling in a vehicle,
mm-hmm.
like a taxi.
Yes.
You don't know the driver.
No.
But you're still a taxi.
Yes.
And you're saying that one day we're going to reach where you're going safely. But anyway, you take the taxi and you reach where you're going safely. So that you have confidence in the driver.
All right. So there are quite a few words that are there. And I want to zero in on one of them. Belief. The confession of faith is a statement of what the Christian believes. right? Now, for those of us who probably grew up in an Anglican background or a Catholic background or a Baptist background, you'll always hear them talk about the Apostles' Creed. Am I right? The Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed speaks to what that person, what they believe the apostles believed in. It could go something like this. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ his only Son, or Lord, right? Who was born of Mary and suffered under Pontius Pilate. And it goes on and on and on. It can be varied, right? But it's belief. So if a confession of faith is a statement or profession of what Christians believe in, what then is the confession of hope? Confession of hope is that what we have as Christians, what do we profess hope in? The blessed hope is what Elder spoke about. The blessed hope is a glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So what Paul is saying here is that as we do good, as we walk this earth, we must hold fast to the belief of in the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. All the confidence we have, all the faith that we have, all the substance that we look forward to that we don't know where it's coming from, is wrapped up in one thing, in the belief that Jesus Christ is coming for those who are faithful. Amen. That hope we confess is a glorious return of Jesus Christ to save us from the world. And that is what we can have confidence in. But the next question is this: how can this hope, how can we stir one another up to love and good works by sharing with others that we believe that Christ is coming again? How do we do that? I mean, we live in a world where people are more irreligious as the days go by. People are no longer believing as strongly as once that this God is coming again. But here Paul says that based on this faith, based on this hope, based on this confidence, we must stir up love and good works in others. How do we do that? How do we stir up love and good works? By this confession of hope without wavering. Anyone? Anyone? No one wants to take it on? How do we do it? All right, let me share some simple ways. We can do it by exhorting and encouraging others with godly preaching and teaching and living. Godly preaching and teaching and living. What do I mean by that? It is often said that people prefer to see a sermon than hear a sermon. Live good in your neighborhood. That's what Susan would say. But I'd say live godly where you're living. Do whatever you're doing in a godly manner. Let people recognize that there is a higher being that you subscribe your life to. Let people realize that it is not just you, but it is the love of someone that is within you right? We live, we pray, we worship, we pray for others. We pray for others. There are some Christians who only pray for themselves because they think they are the only ones who will go to heaven. Not hitting anyone, but just this, no, not past week. 2 weeks ago, a certain church decided to change their teachings because they recognized that what they were doing wasn't something that they were not exclusive to heaven. And they started to teach that heaven is an inclusive place, to the point that their members now can take blood from others. There's some who believe that they are exclusive, that they have right to heaven. And once they are in a relationship with God, then no one else matters. That's not holding on to the hope. Because the hope is the good news that Jesus Christ is coming again. It's good news that Jesus Christ came, you know. But it's better news that Jesus Christ is coming again. It's better news that at the second coming of Jesus Christ, life will be better. At the second coming of Jesus Christ, our lives will be totally transformed. There's some people who don't believe that there's any good except that which they find in this world. And there's not much good in this world. But the hope that we should hold on to, the hope that the confession of that hope that is unwavering reminds men and women that Jesus Christ is coming again, whether we believe it or not, and the signs are fast telling that he is coming again. We must live and support the work of Christ on earth and build this kingdom. What is the work of Christ on earth? So that all should come to repentance, so that everyone knows that there is an invitation to be a part of the kingdom of God. What it means simply, it means that once you have met Jesus, then you must share the good news of salvation. Why must we hold on? It is because we are the hands, the feet, the voice, and the heart of Jesus in this world. Matthew 20 verse 28 says what? Therefore we must act as he did, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. Every Christian community, every Christian church is a community of servants. We are called to serve one another and to serve the community. We are called to serve one another and to serve the community. How do we do this? We are servants to the community. We are servants, those who intercede. We are servants, those who preach the word of God. And we are servants within the church, and we're servants who cooperate with God. Servants. Jesus Christ demonstrated, come in, Brother Paul, that there's an importance in serving. And the greatest example he showed was when he washed the feet of his disciples, the service of humility. Ella Allen.
Yes, Pastor. I like the theme, community of servants. And if the church is really a community of servants, who do we take directives from? And how is it that some servants take matters in their own hand? I would really and truly like you to define the word servants, because it is important that if the church is a community of servants, we must act as servants. And more specifically, bond servants. So I would want you to shed some light on that, Pastor.
All right. I wonder if anybody wants to help me to shed some light. Who are servants? Now, if you want to get into the etymology of the word, you're going to get into a lot of deep things. One of the words that come to us, come in, Sister Will, is the Greek word doulos. And we need to understand that the Greek word doulos, translated servant, is not how we interpret it today. You see, servants today are who? People who come and work in your home doing menial tasks. Am I right? Agree with me? Right? They're at your beckon and call. Some people, they ring the bell and the servant must come. I was watching a documentary about a family, and the phone was right there in the lady's handbag. The servant had just gone to the kitchen to get her water, and she was calling the young lady to come and answer the phone. And the phone was right there in her handbag, doing menial tasks. But is that the meaning that the Bible is trying to get to us? Sister Will is seeking to help me.
Thank you very much. As Pastor spoke about servant, what came to my mind was the great man Naaman and his servant.
Yes.
Was in the house. And even though she was down, because you know we have leaders. Leaders are at the top, and the servants are somewhere there, maybe at the bottom. But sometimes, as leaders, we need to take it from the bottom up, from bottom to up. Because that girl, Christian girl, servant that was in the house, she served the great God, and she was able to tell her master what to do to be cleaned up of his sickness, of his leprosy. So servants for me can be very important. I always say at school, the people who clean the yard are the most important. Because if they do not clean the yard, wash the dishes and so on, we become sick. So I believe servants are important. And in the context of the church, all of us should be servants of the living God. Because Jesus has no other feet than our feet. He has no other hands than our hands. And so we are servants of God.
All right, there are two other replies that we're going to take, and then I will share what. And then Elder Buckley.
Okay, so generally we think of service in the way of employability status. Servants are people employed to work and do these tasks for those in charge, right? And he asked, who do we take directive from? That question came from, okay. So I believe that as a church, what we should do is move as a single unit. And service is not, you don't sit and wait for somebody to say, go ahead and do this. We need this done by whenever. No, right? We need to see what needs done and offer our services and so that persons in need may be able to see what we are able to do for them and be accepting of that service. So we need to go into our communities and seek out persons in need. You have persons in less status than us, persons with problems, drug problems, persons, delinquents falling out of school. These are all problems in the communities, and the church, I think, should be a big part of creating a solution to these problems. So offering our service should mean that we create a safe space for persons in need to be able to come and request the services offered, and then we go out into our communities and perform these good works.
Okay. Ella Buckley, and then I will share a response.
All right, so what do servants do? They serve. And God has called us to serve. And as you said, Pastor, to serve the family here, to serve the family outside of here in the wider community. So we are called to serve. And God has equipped us with gifts and talents to serve. To address Elder Allen's question more directly, obviously, everybody cannot lead. And if we are to accomplish the mission, then each man can't follow his own idea and his own plan. So that God has gifted his church and organized so that some will take the responsibility of planning and motivating and helping to ensure that the work gets done. That is the leader. We have to, if there is to be peace and harmony, if the work is to progress, obviously everybody cannot lead. So it's not a, Jesus says, we are not to lord it over the people. So it's not a case that I am a leader in the church, so do what I say and I must lord it over people. We are all here to serve. And at the end of the day, all of us, whether I'm elder or pastor or deacon, all of us are in the service of the master, and we must be mindful of that.
Amen. So from the example that I shared, along with everything that was said, service then is an expression of love. It's an expression of love, and it's the love that God gives to us. Now, whether we are ordinary member or the president of the General Conference, we all are affected. We all experience the love of Christ. It is because of Christ's love why he knelt down and washed the feet of the disciples, because he wanted them to recognize that there was no hierarchy. Everyone is at level ground when it comes to the foot of the cross. As Ella says, there might be those who have been asked to lead, but that is to lead others to express this love of Christ to the community, the church community, and the community at large. Right? Time is going. The Bible shares about servant metaphors. The lesson speaks about community of servants. When we look in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Ephesians chapter 2, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, Romans chapter 12, these all speak about the spiritual gifts. And if we recognize everyone is given a spiritual gift, there are some who are given more than one, and that spiritual gift is given to be utilized in the service of God. Now, when we look at the spiritual gifts, these are what can also be termed as servant gifts. So there are some who are servants in the area of hospitality. There are some people, when you go someplace, you don't have to think that you want to go back there again. They're warm. They're friendly. They're welcoming. That is servant word, but it's through hospitality. And as Paul speaks in these chapters, Corinthians, Ephesians, 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians and Romans chapter 12, we need to understand that each spiritual gift is an avenue of service for God and service to man. Service for God and service to man. Who do we relate to? First of all, we surrender to God so we can fulfill His will in us. This involves serving others. Romans 12, verse 1, a living sacrifice. We need to also realize that Christ is the head, and we all are part of the body, the leaders, everyone, and we serve the world as He did according to our ability. Romans chapter 12, verse 20. We also recognize that God has called us to announce reconciliation both between us and between God and us. We are ambassadors for Christ. The whole matter of being ambassadors speak to living in a foreign land. But in that foreign land, that building that you're in is as if you're in your own land. So for example, the United States Embassy in Kingston is not owned by Jamaica. It's owned by the United States. And on that plot of land, it's U.S. laws that govern that building. It's the same with us. We are ambassadors for God. We are citizens of another world, but living in this world. And as we live in this world, we must recognize that our presence shares the smell of our community. Our presence in this land, in this world, shares the smell of our community. What is the community of the Christian? It's not this world. It is heaven. And we, as we serve, we, as we live, we, as we preach, we, as we share, must allow people through us to smell the sweet aroma of heaven. Or taste what heaven is like by what we do, by how we live, by what we share. We are servants in the community. As we are in the community, we are persons who intercede. We see that Moses loved the people of Israel and argued with God, rejecting God's suggestion. Moses was willing to lose his own salvation to save his people. As we live in our communities as servants, one of the best things we can do is pray for where we live. You didn't get that. It missed you. Sometimes people won't have the time to stop and listen to you. But as a child of God, you can hear, you can know that something is happening in the home of your neighbor. And you can get down on your knees, Ella B., and pray for that home. And that home will be changed by the Spirit of God. We must be servants who intercede. We must be servants who preach. Let your light so shine before men, Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, that they may see your good works. Glorify your Father in heaven. Another problem with this, Brother Allen, is that when they see the good works, we big up with chess. Yeah, man. Yeah, man. Because of me, why, you know. Yeah, you say, me never did I pray for them, trust me. That they was the bond down long time. You say, me never did I pray for them, Brother Pretty. That the wife dead long time. Through me, them a cuss over there, and I go down for me and pray. The man just get loving. And me do that. No, but that's not what the Bible says. As servants, everything that people come with because of us, we must point them to God. Everything that we do that makes someone's lives better in Christ, we must not take the glory. We must point them to God. We must tell them in our lives, in our words, that the kingdom of God is at hand. As we do that, we must look at the whole matter of justice and mercy and love. And we must share that with our brothers and sisters within the organization of the church and outside the church. Finally, we must cooperate. Romans 12, verse 15. So in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belong to all the others. We're a group of people working together can do more than one individual can. And we must always seek to cooperate with each other and share the message of salvation. Finally, Testimonies for the Church, Volume 9, Chapter 13, page 125 says, we're living in a special period of this earth's history. A great work must be done in a very short time, and every Christian is to act a part in sustaining this work. God is calling for all men who will consecrate themselves to the work of soul saving. When we begin to comprehend what a sacrifice Christ made in order to save a perishing world, there will be seen a mighty wrestling to save souls. Oh, that all our churches might see and realize the infinite sacrifice of Christ. Whatever we do, pray, teach, preach, share, must all point to Jesus, must all point to the work that Jesus came to this world as the chief servant to do. What was that work? To save the souls of men and women. As we serve under the chief servant God, Christ, our Lord and Savior, let's make sure that what we do shares the infinite sacrifice of God for humanity. Let's all be servants of Christ.
I'd want to say thanks to Pastor for carrying us through the lesson study. I do pray that we will reflect on these series of lessons, brethren, and that we will, by God's grace, start to act. Not only to talk, but to act. We would realize that this is the last Sabbath in this quarter, and as usual, our kindergarten and primary Sabbath school members are prepared to recite the memory text that they would have learned over these 13 weeks, and they will be coming to present their memory text to us right after we have collected the offering. So I now invite the ushers to come at this time.
Doesn't bother me if the tears you see are happy man of mine. I know the Lord above is looking down in love. He's watching everything I do.
And some sweet day I'll be shouting everywhere while sailing through the blues.
I'm gonna shout,
shout all over heaven what a day it's gonna be.
Gonna sing,
sing, sing, I'll sing the bass.
We'll sing the harmony.
I'll first walk down in the streets of gold in the golden avenue.
And clap my hands and praise the Lord and shout all over heaven.
I'm gonna shout,
shout all over heaven what a day it's gonna be.
Gonna sing,
sing, sing, I'll sing the bass.
We'll sing the harmony.
I'll first walk down in the streets of gold in the golden avenue.
And clap my hands and praise the Lord and shout all over heaven. I'm gonna shout all over heaven what a day it's gonna be.
We're gonna see.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, church. How are you doing this morning? Listen, if you want to know how well you're doing, you should be standing right here looking down at yourself. The smiles, the beautiful faces, the greetings, everything, it's just beautiful. I have a task this morning, a mama task, to welcome you. To welcome you to church today. On behalf of our pastors, leaders, superintendents, and members in general of this church, we want to say welcome to you all. We have some very special people worshiping with us today. And you see, I was trying to get names, but I find out that I was going to run in trouble. So, Sister Sterling, where are you? Where is Sister Sterling? Come here, Sister Sterling. We have some very special people with us here today. Can you remind me of who they are?
Okay. So, Brother Price, today we have worshiping with us, and we're so happy to have them among us, the Guild of Students from the Maypeng chapter.
That's right.
Of the University of the West Indies Open Campus Maypeng site. I see some faces that I know,
yes,
right here.
Yes, nothing wrong if you put your hands together for them.
Yes, so we are very happy that they chose to worship with us today. And today marks their semester of activity. And today,
You think that is a coincidence? Huh? No, it is the will of God. They start their worship service today, and they are with us today. Don't give them another hand for me, man.
Amen. So today being their annual church service, and thankfully they chose the Maypeng Seventh-day Adventist Church, and we're so happy to have them. And the Lord surely works in a mysterious way. And while we're honoring our principals and teachers, at the same time we are blessed to have representatives from the University of the West Indies worshiping with us. So we are going to ask all the representatives here to stand.
Just stand for us. We want to recognize you.
If you're an employee, if you are a facilitator, if you're a present student, past student, once you're a member of the University of the West Indies, in any of these forms, we are going to ask that you stand and be recognized.
And we are going to say amen,
amen
for them. And let me just extend that standing.
And
now,
brother,
as you stand,
brother
I'm
Price,
going to ask everybody, if you're a visitor here at Maypeng Seventh-day Adventist Church, can you just stand with us this morning?
Amen.
Let me hear the church say
amen.
Well,
no, I wanted to say something, but it's fine.
Well, yeah. Okay. Welcome. God welcomes you. Let me just share something with you. It's not just mere coincidence why you are in church today. We have planned today with you in mind. Whether we welcome, whether we sing, whether we pray, whether we praise, whatever we do it with you in mind. And we want to extend to you the master teacher, God himself, who if you follow his example, you can't go wrong. Brother Pretty, welcome to you, sir. Welcome. And I'm going to ask you to help me to welcome our visiting friends now. What can you do? What can you do to help me to welcome them?
We want to greet somebody in Jesus' name. We want to tell them that we love them. Everybody's...
Let's go together now.
Somebody in Jesus' name, let us tell them that we love them. In Jesus' name, tell them we can work together. In Jesus' name,
everybody smile.
Jesus loves you. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. So smile, smile, smile. Everybody smile, smile, smile. Everybody smile, smile, smile. Everybody smile. Why won't you smile, smile, smile? Everybody smile, smile, smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile. And won't you greet somebody in Jesus' name and let us tell them that we love them. In Jesus' name, tell them we can work together. In Jesus' name, everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you.
Let me tell you something. You see, those who are coming late, they will find that greeting in you when they come. The smile is beautiful. Have a wonderful day.
Have a few of our children here. They will be sharing their memory verses for the past quarter. So we have a mixture of kindergartens and primaries, I'm afraid to say. Some of them may be not here because of the weather. All right.
Lesson one, the little prince. Love each other like brothers and sisters. Romans 12, verse 10. Okay. I will sing to the Lord, highly exalted. Exodus verses 1. Joshua did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. 2 Chronicles 34, verse 2.
I am a hiding place. Psalm 32, verse 7.
Lesson 7. Submit to him and he will make your path straight. Proverbs 3, verse 7. Not verse 6.
Amen. Your word is a lamp for my feet and a light of my path. Psalms 119, verse 105.
Amen. Lesson 12. The Bereans received the great message with eagerness. And examine the scriptures to see if what Paul said was right.
Amen.
Acts 17, verse 11.
Okay, let's share a little song with you. King Jesus is all.
Jesus is all.
My all in all.
My all in all.
And I know that he'll answer.
And I know that he answered. Walking by my side,
I'm satisfied.
King Jesus is all. Jesus is ours.
My all in all.
My all in all.
King Jesus is ours.
My all in all.
My all in all.
And I know that he
answers. And I know that he answers.
Me when I call.
Walking by my side.
Satisfied.
King Jesus is ours.
My all in all.
My all in
Amen. As we say goodbye from Sabbath school, we would have been introduced to the man from Nazareth who has changed the lives of so many people. It is said that the children of God are called to be representatives of Christ, showing forth the goodness and mercy of the Lord as Jesus was revealed to us. The true character of the Father, so we are to reveal Christ to a world that does not know his tender, pitying love. Jesus says, "As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. I in them, and you in me, that the world may know that thou hast sent me." Brothers and sisters, as we go through our life's experience, our life's journey, let us live the life that Jesus lived so that others may see in us him and come to serve him. I now invite Brother Akeem Thompson, who will close us off with a message in song. Have a wonderful Sabbath.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Praise the Lord. Let me see you wave your hands for Jesus this morning. We are alive and well. Are you happy to be alive this morning? Are you happy to be alive this morning? Let me hear you give God the highest praise. Amen.
Search for life's meaning, enslaved by the world and my greed. When the door of my prison was opened by love, spirit, I was free. I'm free from the fears of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of my past. Oh, I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last. I'm free from the guilt that I carried, from the dull, empty life I'm set free. For when I met Jesus, he made me complete,
and he forgot the foolish child I used to be. Oh, I'm free from the fears of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of my past. Oh, I've traded my circles for a glorious song. I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last. Oh, I've traded my circles for a glorious song. I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last.
God bless you.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. We are so blessed and highly favored today. We have in our midst some distinguished educators. We are very happy to have you worshiping with us today. We, as a church community, want to say to you, we appreciate you. We appreciate your service. We recognize that you have been doing a wonderful job. You have been transforming our society, and we are grateful, we are appreciative. Is there anybody inside here this morning who can think back on their school days and identify a teacher that stands out, somebody that really helped to shape you and mold you and to transform you into the person you are today? Do I have any witnesses? Praise the Lord. I think of my grade one teacher, Mrs. Hughes, at Maypen Primary School. God bless her memory. Wonderful teacher. And so, educators, we know that sometimes your work is unthankful. We think that we are unappreciated. Sometimes we hit our heads against the wall. We don't know what to do with some of our students. We sometimes think, boy, this is a bad crop. But still, we try and we push. We push. Teachers, you are caregivers. You are police officers sometimes, lawyers, parents, motivators, coaches. You do so much. And we really, as a church, want to say we are very grateful to you. Sometimes when we think of our teachers, you know, they are people who we spend the majority of our time with growing up. And sometimes we feel like we hate our teachers, especially when they are pushing us so hard. But when we look back, we recognize that they meant well, and we love them and appreciate them for all that they have done. And so, educators in our midst, today, it is your day. We just want to let you know we love you, we appreciate you, and we wish for you God's continued blessings. I'm going to invite Elder Wind, who herself is a distinguished educator, to come and share a few words of admonition with you at this time.
Good morning, church, and our specially invited awardees. Special good morning to you, and added welcome to your being here today. Today I find it an honor to just share with you a few thoughts, a few words. Whatever I say, I think you understand it will come from the heart, because I have been there too. I chose to call you this morning unsung heroes, because educators are often unsung heroes. And if you look back on all the persons that have been named heroes they had a teacher somewhere who guided them into the path that led them to where they could be considered heroes. Today our church has chosen to acknowledge the work of you, unsung heroes of education in our community. Unsung heroes are persons who have served or who are serving and have served well. They are persons who have influenced lives and sometimes changed lives radically too, because so many times, even as I speak, you can think of persons who were going the wrong way, and by your intervention, you see them have come out and come out well. Unsung heroes are persons who go beyond the call of duty in order to accomplish the tasks that they have set themselves to do. And so, we see you as persons who have impacted life in your space in very positive ways. To paraphrase one of the great writers who comment on what teachers and educators do, Thomas Mann, he points out that if you work on metal or marble, time will efface it. And you know that many times when you go and see plaques that are put up in memory of persons, rain and sunshine deteriorate it, and so they always have to replace it. But as a teacher, you have been given the extraordinary opportunity to work upon the minds of young people. And he says that when you work upon the minds of young people and imbue them with the just principles of God, you train them not only for time, but for eternity. That's who a teacher is and what a teacher does. Yes, you are persons who get the job done right against odds and obstacles. And don't we know the Jamaican education system? Many times it's your personal input that get things done. Many times, as our elder says, it is that you tear your hair out, but you are committed to the task to get it done. And so this morning, we want to say to you that it is through your courage, your strength of character, your strength and conviction to and dedication to duty why we at the Maypen Seventh-day Adventist Church chose you to be here this morning to tell you that the community sees what you're doing, we see what you're doing, and we just want to give you that little fillip to say, continue to do what you're doing, because you're doing a great job and you're influencing the lives of so many others. Today, we want to tell you that you have made the world a better place. And those who have been in the profession for a little longer, like Dr. Preddy over there, special congratulations to you, Mr. Preddy. Let's give him a round of applause, you know. He was just honored in the last graduation of NCU, and he's now Dr. Preddy. You know that almost anywhere you go, you can see persons who come up to you and remind you of something you did or something that you're doing that has influenced their life. And if you should think, teachers, younger and older ones, of all the people whose lives you have impacted, who have become professionals and artisans and persons who are holding their own in societies with integrity and honesty, and the lives they will impact, you cannot compute what the success story of any one teacher's input in that life. Because as you influence one, and that other one influences 10, and that 10 influences another 100, do you see the multiplier effect of your influence? That is who an educator is, and that is who what an educator does. Your life has been a life of service. And I want to emphasize that your life is a life of service. And I am even tempted to say that it is a ministry, because teaching has got to be a ministry. Because if you are to impact the minds of persons, how can you impact the minds of persons unless your own mind is impacted by the master teacher. You're going to be held accountable for what happens to that mind, that pliable mind that you have in your hand. Preschool, kindergarten, primary school, high school, university, you are impacting minds. And therefore, I know you know that you have to put your hands in the hands of the man who has been named the master teacher if you are to do the job well. Yes. And I want to distinguish in this short moment what it is to have a job as different from you're doing service. There are too many of us still who have a job and look for a job. And I want to say that, at least in my mind, persons who have a job is that they look work. We come to look at work. And you notice the people who come to look at work, they want to know first, what are the financial gains that will come for it? And self is the motivation for them to come and look at work. But who would be a teacher if that was your motivation? Where's the remuneration? Where is the joy? Except it is a joy that comes because you have a desire to serve. And therefore, as a teacher, I want to say to you that you give service, and we recognize that you have been giving service and want to encourage you to continue. You want to share yourself and to share the things that have happened to you that you want to see happen to others, that they grow and develop and become what God wanted them to become. Yes, you want money. Who doesn't want pay for service? The Bible says the laborer is worthy of his hire. So you should be paid, and you should be paid well. But that is not your motivation. Your joy comes from seeing others achieve and become a whole contributing member of the society, and not just here, but in the world to come. Yes, you go beyond the call of duty, and the prayer of St. Francis de Assisi probably is applicable to you. In that prayer, he says, teach us, good Lord, to serve thee as you deserve, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to labor and not to ask for reward, to toil and not to seek for rest. And he goes on to say that the only thing we look for is that we do your will, and that is walking as the master teacher did. As I could go on very long to tell you a lot of things, but I want to say to you, the master teacher, he demonstrated what it is to care for people and to build people. And I want to congratulate you, because that is what you are doing as you do this. So you're indeed walking in the footsteps of the master teacher. Yes, we want to, as a church, applaud you. And although we give you plaques or gifts today, this is only an award. But I want to tell you that the great reward will be yours if you continue to do your work faithfully and well. I think Paul speaks of you when he says, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you faint not. So today, my exhortation is to you, don't faint. Continue to do well. And today is just part of the due season that's coming to you. We as a church recognize that you are doing a good work. We want you to continue to mold minds, to impact societies, and to build others, even if you are out. Because once a teacher, I don't think you can ever change. And one day, I pray that for you, you will hear the well done. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of my Lord. Congratulations to you for a work that you're doing well done. And I want to say to you, continue to do, to inspire, to build, and to shape lives. May God bless you today.
Thank you, Elder Wind. And as Elder Wind said, educators, we would not have, even if we had money, we would not have enough to award you or reward you for the great work that you've been doing. So these small plaques that we are going to be handing out to you, please, they are but small tokens of our appreciation. And as Elder says, we hope that the master teacher himself will give you your true reward hereafter. So I'm going to invite our honorees to come forward as I call your names. And I would invite our pastor to please come forward to present the plaques to our awardees. Okay, can I invite Dr. Winston Preddy to come forward at this time? I didn't say it, but I think most of us here know that Dr. Preddy is the principal at Maypen High School. And Major Paul Scott, principal of Maypen Primary School. You came right on time, sir. I invite you forward. Thank you, Major Scott. Dr. Marsha Smalling at Glenmuir High School. Dr. Smalling is not here with us today, but Mrs. Francis will represent her and receive the plaque on her behalf. And our final principal that we are recognizing today is Mr. Adrian Sinclair, who is the principal at Effortville Primary School. Unfortunately, he could not be here today, but we want to publicly say thanks for his service. You could still give him a round of applause. Thank you, Pastor. Invite Sister Clark, who is the wife of our intern pastor, Sister Tamara Clark. I'm going to invite her now to present to our other educators. We have, and these educators have served for 30 years or more. Isn't that phenomenal? Come on, let's recognize them. Okay. Mrs. Luan Slowly, Mineral Heights Primary School. Thank you. Mrs. Phyllis Jackson, St. Thomas More Preparatory School. Mrs. Winsome Atkinson, Hazard Primary School. Mrs. Rona Bernard, Denby Primary School. All right. Mrs. Carlene Jennings, Maypen Infant School. Carlene Jennings, Maypen Infant School. Mrs. Carol Robotham Graham, Glenmuir Preparatory School. Mrs. Mary Bryan, Central High School. Miss Lucille Blake, Central High School. And we also have Miss Yuvelin Daly, who from Central High as well. Unfortunately, she couldn't be here today, but we thank you all for your service. I'm going to invite Pastor Daphne Henry at this time to, if she's still in the house, to come and do the special dedicatory prayer for our awardees. All right, I ask all our awardees to stand at this time as Pastor Henry comes to pray God's blessings over your lives.
We invite the others of you to bow reverently as we pray. Our gracious eternal Father, our God, our friend, in the precious name of Jesus, we come to you this morning acknowledging your great love, your wisdom, and your rulership over the children of men. We thank you, gracious God, that you still guide the hands and the wheels of this world. And you have inspired the administration of this church, O God, to put this service together whereby we might recognize the work and the contribution of these servant leaders. They have led the nation in a very special way, O God. We have seen that there are so many that have passed through the system that have been a blessing to this country. But there are also those who have fallen through the cracks. And those, O gracious God, who are here this morning, I pray that you might inspire them, that if there is anything extra they can do to save, especially our young boys particularly in the community of Maypen, O God. We pray that you will guide every time the session is open, that teachers will be inspired to start lessons with prayer everywhere and in every school. We know it cannot be done, O God, without you. We are begging you, save our nations, not only through the churches, not only through the individual families at home, but through our school. Bless, O gracious God, the work of those we honor. May they be written down in the Lamb's Book of Life, that you yourself will say to them, the end of the ages, well done, thou good and faithful servant. O gracious God, I pray that you will bless their families, that you will encourage them. We know this situation is not easy with indiscipline in our community today. It is not easy, but I beg you, God, give them the patience they need. Give favor to their individual lives and help them to stay the course. Oh, gracious God, I pray that every teacher under the hearing of my voice will hear, if they have not heard before, the clarion call of Jesus, calling them to come closer to him, to have sweet fellowship with him today. And when time turns into eternity, May all our teachers be saved, is my prayer in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. In closing, I just want to share a little story that's a favorite of mine. You may have heard it before, but I think as educators we say, repetition deepens impression. As Blessed prepares to come and close with a special dedicatory song to our educators. A CEO asked a teacher a kind of rude question about her job. She responded eloquently. The dinner guests were all sitting around the table discussing life. One man, the CEO, decided to explain the problem with education. He argued, "What's a kid going to learn from someone who decided his best option in life was to become a teacher?" To stress his point, he said to another guest, "You're a teacher, Bonnie. Be honest. What do you make?" Teacher Bonnie, who had a reputation for honesty and frankness, replied, "You want to know what I make?" She paused for a second, then began, "Well, I make kids work harder than they ever thought they could. I make a C+ feel like the Congressional Medal of Honor. I make kids sit through 40 minutes of class time when their parents can't make them sit for 5 minutes without an iPad, a GameCube, or a movie rental. Do you really want to know what I make?" She paused again and looked at each and every person sitting at the table. "I make kids wonder. I make them question. I make them respect and take responsibility for their actions. I teach them how to write. Keyboarding isn't everything. I make them read, read, read. I make them show all their work in math. They use their God-given brain, not a man-made calculator. I make my students from other countries learn everything they need to know about English while preserving their unique culture identity. Finally, I make them understand that if they use the gifts they were given, work hard, and follow their hearts, they can succeed in life." Bonnie paused one last time, then continued, "Then, when people try to judge me by what I make, I can hold my head up high and pay no attention because they are ignorant. You want to know what I make? I make a difference in all your lives, educating your kids and preparing them to become CEOs and doctors and engineers. What do you make, Mr. CEO?" His jaw dropped and he went silent. Teachers, as I close, I'm encouraging you to continue, whether you're still in the classroom or not, because as Elder Wynn says, once a teacher, you're always a teacher. Don't educate your children to be rich. Educate them to be happy so they know the value of things, not just price. May God continue to bless you. And when all is said and done, when you have fought your good fight and you have kept the faith, I know that you would want to hear Jesus himself give you that commendation. Well done. God bless you. Blessed.
strength to meet this day. Lead us by your holy word, guide us in your way.
For life is filled with winding turns, we have often lost our that you lead today.
Give us love that's true, oh Lord, trusting as a child. Love for to heal the heart and not turn away anyone who is in need. All we ask is teach us love indeed.
Sabbath Church. These are the announcements for today, September 28th. Please keep in mind, coming up from October 12th to 19th is the CJC Community Service Department Week of Kindness. All community service leaders are being asked to partner with other non-governmental organizations in the community to make it a success.
The Bible Boom continues this afternoon with the Manchester Federation versus the Central St. Catherine at St. John's Church. The finals and award presentation will be on October 5th at the Asia Church in Manchester. The Heritage Quiz Finals will be on Sabbath, October 12, 2019.
Lay Preachathon 2019 will be from November 9th, 23rd, and all our youth are invited to participate. The The CJC's Women Ministries Department will have its retreat from October 4th to 6th at the Grand Palladium Resort and Spa with the theme Reshaping My Story. For further details, please speak to Sister Michelle Ludford or local Women's Ministry Leader.
The Men Ministries Department of our conference presents its Men and Beams, Brothers of Excellence and Moral Standards, convention on Sabbath, October 26th at Camp Verley. The theme is A Real Man at Home. For more information, please speak to Elder Howard Hattie.
This is a reminder to the church to continue to pray at 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. daily for the overall function of the church, its evangelistic efforts, sick and shut-in members.
We have a few bulletins from the Clarendon AY Federation, Sabbath 28, which is today, the Senior Youth and Master Guide Training at the Maypen High School. All Master Guides and Senior Youth in Training are expected to be in attendance. All Adventures and Pathfinders are asked to be a part of the very important and special Adventure and Pathfinder Honors Day to be held on Sunday, September 29, that is tomorrow, starting at 9 a.m. and will end at 2 p.m. at the Maypen High School. Children are asked to wear comfortable clothing and shoes. All children are asked to take water and snacks. October 12th, Clarendon AY Federation AGM, that is the annual general meeting, election of officers, and Federation executive meeting will be at the Lionel Town SDA. The Federation meeting is at 2:30 and the AGM will begin at 4:30 p.m.
I have a letter here from Ray Scores, Seventh-day Adventist Church. It reads, Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, trust that you are enjoying the blessings of the Lord in your special, in your personal and corporative lives. We will be hosting a yard sale and luncheon on the church grounds on Sunday, October 20th, 2019, to which you are invited to participate. Enclosed are 10 luncheon tickets that we are asking you and your members to purchase in support of this venture. We asked also that you post the enclosed poster on your notice board to serve as a reminder and advertisement of this event. The proceeds from this event is in support of the purchase of an adjacent piece of property to our church. May contact Sister Aveline Henry at 264-2171 or Martin Brown at 803-9671 for additional information that you may need relating to this event. Thanks in anticipation of your kind support.
For prayer requests, this is a reminder to the church to continue to pray at 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. daily for overall functions of the church in its evangelistic efforts, sick and shut-in members. Condolences, illness and funerals, there will be two funeral services here tomorrow. The first will be at 10 a.m. for Brother Galbraith and the second for Sister Marian Bowes at 1 p.m. Let us pray for and support these families as they grieve. Pastor Daphne Henry, that is worshiping with us today, has lost her mom. The funeral service will be on October 5th at the Grovetown SDA in South Manchester. The funeral begins at 11 a.m. There will be a bus leaving from here at the Maypen SDA. Those interested should give their names to Elder Buckley. Sister Floria Sullivan passed away last week. Funeral details will be shared as soon as they become available. Please pray for her family, including her father, Brother Owen Sullivan, as they grieve.
All right, so those celebrating birthdays for today and the coming week are Brother Odin Levy on September 28th, that's today. Sister Delia Allen, September 28th, also today. Brother Paul Harris, today as well. Sister Michaela Ferguson on September 30th. Sister Hallie Francis on September 30th. Brother Errol Ricketts on October 1st. Sister Doreen Barrett on October 3rd. Sister Amisha Thompson on October 3rd. And Brother Michael Ferguson on October 4th. We have some special people here with us today, and we will like to welcome you to our service.
So we'd like to have, we have a little point for you that we would like to share.
All right, so for educators, educators paint their minds and guide their thoughts, share their achievements and advise their faults, inspire a love of knowledge and truth. As you light the path which leads our youth, for our future brightens with each lesson you teach, each smile you lengthen, each goal you help reach, for the dawn of each poet, each philosopher and king begins with our educator and the wisdom they bring.
Wonderful. We'd also like to welcome the Open Campus Guild of Students and the staff. Also, is there any visitors with us today? Being here for the first time? All right, right here and at the back. Wonderful. We'd like to welcome each and every one of you here. For those who are regular members, again, welcoming every one of you here today. We hope you have a blessed day. Happy Sabbath.
It's a wonderful thing to be in the house of the Lord, to give God praise and to adore his matchless name. We come out of an experience with him this past week to worship his name in the beauty of holiness. Amen. So we welcome you to the Seventh Adventist Church right here at Maypen, and we hope that as you worship, heaven will come down and glory will fill your souls. We also welcome those who are joining us on our YouTube channel. And if by any means you should miss something today, then you can later on search YouTube channel for Maypen Seventh-day Adventist Church, and you'll be able to see the entire day's program on that channel. Just joining those who gave us our announcements this morning, our family, church family, has been experiencing loss. We have lost more members, as we heard, Brother Amiel Galbraith's funeral, that will be at 10 tomorrow. Sister Marion Bowes, her Thanksgiving service will be at 1 tomorrow. And for now, the Thanksgiving service for Sister Sullivan is on the 16th of October. If there are any changes to that, we will let you know. Pastor Daphne Henry, who served with us here, left, but she has returned because of the loss of her mother. We heard the date right, but the correction is the church is the Church of God of Prophecy in Grovetown, and that's on the 5th of October. The Church of God of Prophecy on the 5th of October. That is when the Thanksgiving service will be. Now, we are fast coming to the close of the year, and we have been having a wonderful year thus far, especially with our young people. And there is something great, there is something grand, there is something wonderful that will take place on the 13th of October. On the 13th of October, it will be, this place will be transformed. This place will be transformed as we have or Youth Evening of Excellence Awards ceremony right here, starting at 3:30 in the afternoon. Now, I know that you have been hearing about this, but I'm not quite sure if you have had your tickets yet. Your ticket is a part of your banquet clothes, so you can't get in the banquet without a ticket. Amen? Amen? Amen. And so we want to make sure that everyone who needs to be there is there, and we all need to be there, but I'm not quite sure if we all have tickets yet. And so at this time, there are some persons who are around. They are at strategic locations. If you are here and you are a member of the church, this Sunday afternoon, your rice and peas will be cooked for you. This Sunday afternoon, your chicken and your fish will be cooked for you. This afternoon, your your veggie meat will be cooked for you. This afternoon, the 13th of October, your meal will be cooked and served to you. You don't have to go around the fireside. Sorry, they don't do fireside anymore. It's here from the country, Brother Pretty. So every Sunday we used to go around the fireside. You don't have to stand around the stove, whether it be gas or electric, on Sunday the 13th of October. You'll be served. You'll be served in style. You'll dine in style right here on the grounds of the St. Bemis Church at Maypen. But you need to have this wonderful piece of ticket in your hand. You might not have it. I'm not going to tell you the cost now because you have heard it before. What we need to make sure is that your dinner is secure. Your plate is secure. Your knife and fork is secure. Your ice cream is secure. Your dessert is secure. So, those who have not yet had their tickets, I am seeing Sister Althea, I'm seeing Sister Kadeen. Where are the others? They have their tickets. They have your tickets with you. There might, Elder Buckley has tickets also. So those who have not had their tickets yet and you want to relax that Sunday evening with our young people, we'll be awarding, there'll be educational awards, there'll be service awards during this weekend, this Sunday afternoon. We need to make our young people know that we appreciate what they are doing. Amen? And our young people have been doing well, especially when it comes to their educational achievement. They have been doing well, exceptionally well. And so there are those who have tickets. If you don't have a ticket, no, this is not about the dream now. If you don't have a ticket right now, we need to get one in your hand. Amen. So if you don't have a ticket and you want to raise your hand and you want to support the young people, I mean, with an evening like this, the saxophonist that is coming, the MC that is coming, the price printed on the ticket is just minimal for the service that will be rendered. Dining in style with the youth of the Maypen Seventh-day Adventist Church on their Youth Evening of Excellence Awards Ceremony. Do you have your tickets? If you don't have your tickets and you need one now, you can take it and you can talk with them later. Just raise that hand. Just raise that hand. Is there one? Is there one without a ticket this morning? Is there one? This is the promotion. Is there one without a ticket this morning? There's a hand. There are two hands on the floor. I thought they got their tickets already. We don't want them to put it down right here, right here, right here. Is there another hand? Is there a hand to the back? Kirkwin, you had your hand up? No, he's just holding his head, wondering what to take on that afternoon. There are two hands right here. Is there anyone else? Not with a ticket, but you need to have your ticket. All right, while you're doing that, there are some persons who have tickets for you. Sister Francis has tickets. Elder Buckley has tickets. Sister Kadeen Morrison has tickets. Anybody else? There are many others who might have. Sister Hope Sterling has tickets. Make sure that you have your ticket. It's not a ticket for your dream. Just a ticket to share with the young people on the 13th of October. On the 13th of October. All AY Pathfinder and Adventurer members of the directorate, that is the directors, the associate directors, the secretaries, please be reminded of your meeting during lunch in the vestry on the wing to the pastor's vestry. That's all AY Pathfinder and Adventure personnel. Please be reminded of your meeting this afternoon during lunch on the wing to the vestry. I think you know exactly what that is all about. Welcome was extended to the Guild, of students, but we weren't quite sure which university they're from. So we have the students from the MAPEN chapter, Open Campus, the lecturers, past students who are here. They're marking the semester activities, today being the day for their annual church service. They have sought to join us, amen, to join us in worship today. We have the president of the Guild, the MAPEN Chapter Guild of the UA Open Campus, the Guild of Students, Ms. Anita Mitchell. And I'm just going to ask her to share a word of greetings with us this morning and to ask those who have come to join us in worship. This is their church service for the beginning of their school year, and they have decided to join with us. Amen.
Greetings to Pastor Grant and to the church. Happy Sabbath. And a very special greetings to all the educators present with us today. As was said before, my name is Anita Mitchell, and I am the chapter chair for the MAPEN Open for the MAPEN site, Open Campus Guild of Students, and I also sit on the regional body as the returning officer. I just want to say thank you for allowing us to worship with you today. I also stand here to bring greetings on behalf of the Guild President, Miss Nikisha Jankis. She cannot be present as she resides in Antigua. Just going to explain briefly what the Guild is all about. The Guild of Students is the official body for student representation on the open campus of the University of the West Indies. It was established as the Guild of Undergraduates and was later changed to the Guild of Students to include not only persons studying for undergrad degrees, but also graduate students. All registered students pursuing a course of study at the University of the West Indies open campus are full members of the Guild. The Guild is entrusted with promoting and fostering development towards the educational, social, cultural, and economic interests of all its Guild members. And of course, I cannot take my seat without saying what an exciting time it is to be a member of the University of the West Indies, especially of that of the Open Campus. We just launched our fifth campus, so you would have known our traditional four campuses, Mona, St. Augustine, Cave Hill, and of course the Open Campus. And we recently launched our fifth campus, which is the Five Island Campus that is in Antigua. We have also received our reaccreditation for the length of 7 years. So all our courses are without a doubt world class. And also we have been named number one in the Caribbean as a university. I just want to say good morning to everybody who has ever been a member of or a student of the University of the West Indies. And I just want to ask you to just stand where you are so we can just acknowledge you and give you a round of applause, please. If you have ever taken a course of study with the University of the West Indies, can we applaud them, please? One of applause, please. Thank you very much, and happy Sabbath.
We welcome you, and we hope that as you worship today, then you will, as you sit at the feet of the master teacher, will learn that he desires the best for all, and the best is that we all enter into the promised land. We are on the verge of our in-gathering campaign. We have not received the material yet for in gathering, but we have received a goal that we do not really want. right? We will hear next week what that preferred goal will be. But we just want to say, brothers and sisters, that it's in gathering time again, and we are expecting all, as we did last year, to participate and participate well. Because when we do, 90% of that which we overflow comes back to us for the utilization in our church and in our community. Just also reminding us, next week's Sabbath, the first Sabbath of October, we will be collecting that special offering that will be remitted to Jamaica Union Conference for our brothers and sisters in the Bahama Islands. They are people who are still in need, and despite what we have seen and heard, we need to give that assistance to our brothers and sisters. If there are persons here who are prepared to give that offering today, then we ask that you use one of our tithe envelopes and mark Bahamas offering on it. Whatever is given will be remitted to the Jamaica Union Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. Have a wonderful Sabbath and a blessed time as we worship our Lord.
Thank you, Pastor. As we continue our divine worship service today, our Spirit of Prophecy reading comes to us from the 30th chapter of The Desire of Ages. It is titled, He Ordained 12. This is an excerpt coming from pages 254 to 255. It reads thus. He who called the fishermen of Galilee is still calling men to his service, and he is just as willing to manifest his power through us as through the first disciples. However imperfect and sinful we may be, the Lord holds out to us the offer of partnership with himself, of apprenticeship with Christ. He invites us to come under the divine instruction that, uniting with Christ, we may work the works of God. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the exceeding greatness of the power may be of God and not from ourselves. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. This is why the preaching of the gospel was communicated to erring men rather than to the angels. It is manifest that the power which works through the weakness of humanity is the power of God. And thus, we are encouraged to believe that the power which can help others as weak as ourselves can help us. And those who are themselves compassed with infirmity should be able to have compassion on the ignorant and on them that are out of the way. Hebrews 5, verse 2. Having been in peril themselves, they are acquainted with the dangers and difficulties of the way, and for this reason are called to reach out for others in like peril. There are souls perplexed with doubt, burdened with infirmities, weak in faith, and unable to grasp the unseen. But a friend whom they can see, coming to them in Christ's stead, can be a connecting link to fasten their trembling faith upon Christ. We are to be laborers together with the heavenly angels in presenting Jesus to the world. With almost impatient eagerness, the angels wait for our cooperation. For man must be the channel to communicate with man. And when we give ourselves to Christ in wholehearted devotion, angels rejoice that they may speak through our voices to reveal God's love. God bless you.
As we have our call to worship, this is a call for all board members. Next Sunday, October 6th, will be our board meeting. October 6th at 9 will be our board meeting.
Let us all stand for the call to worship. Inside your temple, O God, we think of your constant love. You are praised by people everywhere, and your fame extends over all the earth. You rule with justice. Let the people of Zion be glad. This God is our God forever and ever. He will lend us for all time to come. Church is now called to worship.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Break us, melt us, mold us, fill us, that our worship may be acceptable to your sight. We pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Remain standing for hymn of praise, number 10. Come, Christians, join to sing, number 10.
Church, that is a song we are going to sing. That is a song, but that is not how we're going to sing it. You have to sing this song with meaning. We just go like we called some words a while ago. It don't have any oomph, yes. So we'll have to sing this thing as if we are singing it to God. You have to sing it as if we are singing it to God. Because I tell you the truth, if you sang it like that to me, I wouldn't even accept it. You know why I wouldn't accept it? There are some of you down there, your mouth shut tight like a vice. No, honestly. There are some people in the congregation, their mouth shut tight like they have tetanus. No, and we say we come to sing praise. There are some who were. No, we're going to sing it. We're not going to sing it so fast because we... Listen, we have the whole day to praise the Lord. So we're not going to sing it that fast. So we're going to sing it this time, brothers and sisters. Hold on. And let me tell you something. Let me hear something. When I raise up this song, I want all the male men, only the male men. And when I raise up this, all the ladies, and then put up both, everybody is going to sing. Brother, we're going to open our lungs, and we're going to say, God, I am very happy. I am walking on top of the grass, and the grass isn't on top of me. So come again, brother, musician. A little slow. Give it to me in a heavenly style. And the heavenly style thing is more of waltz than hip hop. So don't let us go so fast with it. Come. Come, children. Come, Christians, join to sing. Hallelujah. It's, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, that's what I say. I heard a man come and say, brethren, give your highest praise. I say, hallelujah. He said, shout out the hallelujah. Amen. Give it to me again, brother musician. We're going to sing this song to the honor and glory of God. Don't go so fast, brother. Don't go so fast at all. Even if the note says go that fast, you're not fast. You're going to fall. So we're going to say, come again. Watch me now. I'm going to conduct it.
Hallelujah, amen. Loud praise to Christ our King. Hallelujah, amen. His throne rejoice, praises his gracious choice. Hallelujah, amen.
Sisters,
come lift your hearts on high. Hallelujah, amen. Let praises fill the sky. He is guide and friend,
yes.
To us condescend,
yes.
His love shall never end. Hallelujah, amen. Praise yet, O Christ, again. Hallelujah, amen. Life shall not end the strain.
Hallelujah,
amen. On heaven's blissful shore, his goodness will adore, singing forevermore. Hallelujah, amen.
Amen.
Please do not sit. It is time for prayer. I'm going to ask, as far as it is possible, if you find it possible to kneel, please do so as we talk to God.
Sovereign God, we have come up to Mount Zion today to worship you. We praise you, we magnify you, because indeed you are worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun until the going down of the same. We thank you, God, that our lives are spared to be in this house of worship today. And, oh God, I pray that our worship may be acceptable. There are those who have come rejoicing. They are celebrating a milestone birthday. I thank you, Lord, for your leading in their lives. And I ask your blessings upon their lives. There are those who have achieved great things, and they have come to give you thanks. We have come to thank you for the work that our educators have been doing in this part of the vineyard. Lord, we pray your continued blessings over them and their families. Lord, help them not to be weary of well-doing, but to continue on this path until they hear from your lips the well done. Lord, thank you for your blessings on our lives. And oh God, we know that there are many times we have taken your blessings for granted, but we ask for your forgiveness. And even as I intercede on behalf of your children now, I pray that you would remove from me anything and everything that is unlike you, so that my prayers may be heard and answered. Lord, even though we are rejoicing and we have come to say thanks, we recognize that there are some in our midst who have come with heavy hearts, burdens, but we are thankful that burdens are lifted at Calvary because you, Jesus, promised to be there to meet us. There are those among our numbers who are bereaved at this time. Oh God, you are the God of all peace and all comfort. I pray that you would succor them today, that you would give them the courage to face the unknown future and to know, God, that whatever happens, you are with them, and earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Thank you, God, for your blessings. We lift up your manservant, Pastor Bignall. You have sent him here today to be your mouthpiece, and I pray that you would bless him, you would speak to him and through him, so that your word will be declared with power and clarity, and your people will be blessed and edified. Remember also the students and the workers from the open campus who are worshiping with us today. I pray your blessings upon them also. Help us all to remember that you are the master teacher. You are the fount of all wisdom. And so we come to you with all the perplexities of this life, and we ask God for your leading and your directive. Bless our worship now, we pray, as we say thanks in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
kingdom cannot fail. There rules o'er earth and hell.
The keys of death and hell are to our Jesus give.
Lift up your hearts,
lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say,
worship the Lord with our offerings. I bring you two reminders today. Remember, sparse sowing, sparse reaping. Sow bountifully and you will reap bountifully. Each person should give as he has decided for himself. There should be no reluctance, no sense of compulsion. God loves a cheerful giver. Remember how generous the Lord Jesus was. He was rich, but he became poor for your sake, to make you rich of his poverty. So like the apostles of old, let us give according to our means and beyond our means as they did, of their own free will. Deacons, please come forward. Let us pray. Father, you're so good to us. You have been so generous to us. You have blessed us so bountifully. Today, we worship you with our tithes, with our offerings, with our whole self. Accept them, O Lord, as you accept us, and make us willing to continue to serve you in every way, that we will bring honor and glory to your name and hasten your soon coming, we pray, in Jesus' name. Deacons will wait on us, and deaconesses.
bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour out for you an overflowing blessing.
We give thee but thine own, or dear the gift may be, all that we have is thine alone, and trust, O Lord, from thee.
Thank you. Please be seated. Children, it's your time. Please come.
Good morning, boys and girls. Happy Sabbath to you. And happy Sabbath to you as well, bigger boys and girls. Yes, so for today, Community Guest Day, the theme is Community Leaders Serving the Master Teacher. And so, for today, the story that I will be telling you today, it is entitled, Life is About Helping Others. What did I say? Excellent. Now, a man was driving his car when he saw an old lady stranded on the side of the road. He saw that she needed help, so he stopped his Honda near her Mercedes and got out. He smiled while he was approaching her. Still, she was worried, as nobody had stopped for hours. Moreover, he did not look safe, as his appearance was so poor and shabby. He could see how frightened she was. So he tried to calm her. I'm here to help you, don't worry. My name is Brian Anderson. What's his name?
Brian.
Yes, man, you're listening. The tire was flat, so he had to crawl under the car while changing the tire. He got dirty and his hands were hurt. When the job was done, she asked how much he owed him for his help. Brian smiled. He said, if you really want to pay me back, the next time you see someone who needs help, give that person the needed assistance and think of me. At the same evening, the lady stopped by a small cafe. That place looked dingy, and dingy means gloomy and sad. Then she saw a waitress, nearly 8 months pregnant, wiping her wet ear with a towel. The waitress had a sweet, friendly smile, although she had spent the day on her feet. The lady wondered how someone who has so little can be so kind and giving to a stranger. Then she remembered Brian. The lady had finished her meal and paid with a $100 bill. The waitress went to get change, and when she came back, the lady was gone. She had left a note on the napkin. You don't owe me anything. Somebody once helped me, just like now I'm helping you. If you really want to pay me back, do not let this chain of love end with you. The waitress found 4 more 100 bills under the napkin. That night, the waitress came home earlier. She was thinking about the lady and the money she left. She was wondering how the lady could know how much she and her husband needed it, especially now when the baby will soon arrive. She knew that her husband worried about that. So she was glad to tell him the good news. Then she kissed him and whispered, No, everything will be all right. I love you, Brian Anderson. I see the kids looking at me all lost, so I'll explain it to them. All right, so the essence of the story, boys and girls, is that one good deed leads to another. So the gentleman who helped the lady with the Mercedes car, yes, his name is Brian Anderson, he stopped to help a lady by the road. The lady wanted to pay him some money for the help that he gave to her, but he did not accept that money. Now, Brian turned out to be married, and his wife worked at a cafe. Now, the lady who Brian helped went to that same cafe, not knowing Brian's wife, and his wife is who served her. So because Brian had been kind to her, she decided in turn to be kind to the waitress. And when the waitress went home, it turned out, as you heard in the story, that her husband was in fact Brian who helped that lady. I'm not sure if it's clearer to you, but I know the bigger persons get it. But as you go today, I hope that you will be kind and helpful to your classmates. Try to help out mommy and daddy. If it's even a kind word, if it's a smile, if it's a hug, whatever small gesture that you can do to be kind, please do so. Who is going to pray for us so that when we go out, we will show kindness to persons who we come across? All right, I'm going to take two prayers. I'm going to take you. I'm going to take you as well. All right. Bow your heads and close your eyes.
Thank you, Jesus, for waking me up this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for keeping me on your blood. God, cover me on your blood. Lord, I love you. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, God, for today. Lord, please to bless us. Please to guide and protect us. Please to cover us, Lord, with your everlasting mercy and grace, Lord. Please to guide us throughout the day and seek us that we may live in your kingdom forevermore. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All right, thank you very much. Have a blessed Sabbath.
I invite the church to please stand at this time for the scripture reading. It comes to us from Luke chapter 4. That's Luke chapter 4, and we will read from verses 16 to 21, and I will read in your hearing. So that's Luke chapter 4, verses 16 to 21. So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recover the sight of the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." Then he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. 21 and last. And he began to say to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Amen. Please be seated.
With the driver of Toyota RS, license plate number 3658HQ. Please attend to your car. The matter is very urgent. Driver of Toyota RS, license plate number 3658HQ. I want to welcome two or four special visitors online who have joined us, Veronica and Marcia from New York. You have joined us. We welcome you and thank you for your wonderful comments. Today, to share the message for the special day, is one who, when I spoke to him, the first thing he said is that I am retired. But then he shared that every Sabbath, since December, since retirement, he has been sharing the word of God. So I thought to myself, it's not R-E-T-I-R-E-D, but R-E-T-Y-R-E-D. And then he said, Pastor, come November, I will only take 2 appointments for each month. This is after 53 years of active service. 10 years he served in the educational system of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in our schools, and the other 43 years in pastoral ministry. This man, though retired and having been retired, still seeks to impact the minds of young people. One member this morning, when she saw the name, got excited and asked me, "True? Really?" And I said, "Yes." I speak of Pastor Derek Bignall, served in the East Jamaica Conference as pastor, as departmental director, as president of that conference, served in the West Indies Union Conference of Seventh Adventists as director and president of West Indies Union, then now Jamaica Union Conference, and since retirement has been serving as a lecturer in the only school at the Northern Caribbean University, the SRT, the School of Religion and Theology. Pastor Derek Bignall is one who knows the Lord, one who has shared this love that God has given him for many, many years, one who punctuates his ministry with singing. And there are many who, when they hear that Pastor Bignall is going to preach, looks for the guitar. I asked that question of him today. He said, "Pastor, the guitar is not here. One of the strings broke. How can I make it up? I'll just have to ask forgiveness." But we saw earlier on that music is still in his blood. So to share God's words with us today from the throne of God is God's manservant, Pastor Derek Bignall, married, adult children, and is retired for the Lord. We give you Pastor Derek Bignall, servant of God, a friend to man, God's man servant with God's message. But before he speaks to us, we will once more hear, as we did before, from the Tabernacle Choir, the song of meditation. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good afternoon, church.
Good afternoon. You know,
church, some of you don't even know what time it is. Whenever I go to a church, I can know if it's a dead church. I just walk around. And I do my analysis and my assessment. And I know a dead church when I see one. And you know a church that is in confusion. When I go to a church and there's no choir, it makes a statement. And if the choir members don't, anytime there's trouble in the choir, you know that the whole church is in trouble. What I am saying today, it's a long time my soul has not been thrilled by the music of a choir like that I've heard today. And I'm telling you, it's one of the reasons, perhaps because I'm the dinosaur, why the thing, you know, hit me like that. Because, you know, I go to church and sometimes the choir sings. One line. Glory to the Lord. Glory to, and after they sing glory to the Lord 50 times. One said, glory. And the other said, glory, glory, glory. But I said, this song finished long time. It's long time this song finished. Why don't you sit down and let the rest of the program work. But I'm telling you, this was an anthem. I think too many churches stopped singing anthems. And I got an anthem to fill my soul today. And then the man behind the organ, listen. I see a lot of you sit down there and you can't even say amen. And that is one of the things why, you know, choir members can get very turned off. Because after you sing like how you sing, and some people down there suffering from lockjaw, something is wrong. Because I'm telling you, one of the hardest things to do in church is to be a choir member. It's one of the hardest jobs to be a member of the choir. Because there are certain people who don't know the difference between do and re. And you sit down there with a very critical ear. The only thing some people don't sit down there waiting for to hear, how they're going to spoil it. What note going to spoil? And if one note is spoiled, or they think one note is spoiled, they talk about it for the whole day. And you sit down there and you don't know how hard they had to practice to spoil that one note. When you're in your bed sleeping, rain fall, and you say, thank God, rain fall, and I'm in my house. They are here. Don't even know how they're going to get back to their homes. Sacrifice. Thank you, choir. Thank you, master musician. Beautiful. And so, today, the theme is Christian or community leaders serving the master teacher. I'm going to make today's, I'm going to be brief today, because generally on a nice warm Sabbath like this, I like to take a good 3 hours. And I'm telling you, when you reach on a day like today, man, and the day is warm, no rain, man, preach, but I'm going to cut it in half. Let us go. In the book of Malachi, chapter 1, says, God says, a son honoreth his father, and a servant his master. If then I be a father, where is mine honor? And if I be a master, where is my fear? Saith the Lord of hosts unto you, O priests that despise my name. And ye say, wherein have we despised thy name? Ye offer polluted bread upon mine altar. And ye say, wherein have we polluted thee? In that ye say, the table of the Lord is contemptible. And if ye offer the blind for sacrifice, is it not evil? And if ye offer the lame and the sick, is it not evil? Offer it now unto thy governor. Will he be pleased with thee or accept thy person? Saith the Lord of hosts. And now I pray you, beseech God that he will be gracious unto us. This hath been by your means. Will he regard your persons? So here God had a little problem with community leaders and their service. Because the community leaders just chuck it to God. So take it. And God says, listen, who are you giving this to? You couldn't give this to your parish council. The councillor. You couldn't give this to your MP. You wouldn't give this to your prime minister or leader of opposition. Which one is closer to your political preference? And you're bringing that to me. And I want to tell you that we have given God said, you brought lame and sick. I say, what's wrong with that? And let me tell you something, church. It is a low down behavior that church members have toward. Let me, 60, 70 years ago, when you come to an Adventist church and the only car you saw, when you see a car come up, you know that pastor come. Yeah. Because nearly everybody had to walk. I know some people who used to ride a horse. A few would ride a bicycle. But you see, when 9:15 comes, Sabbath school start. Amen. I'm telling you. And some people walk 3, 4, 5 miles one way. And when 9:15 comes, Sabbath school start, church full. And if you don't mind, now we have more car than people. And brethren, some of the brethren come after offering is collected. I'm telling you. Chuck it on God. Chuck it on God. My wife told me that at a certain church, one of the church elders got up and said, some of you are tipping God, tipping God. Because some of us come to church and not even a box juice money. Not even a box juice money for offering. And the Bible says, bring an offering and come in. As a matter of fact, I tell you something. This is 70, 80 years ago. Every service in the church, you collected an offering. You come Sabbath school, you collect offering. Divine service, AY, Sunday night. And some very intelligent stewardship director come up with a plan. You don't have to bring offering every time you come to church. Just put it in an envelope once and it suffices for the whole. So they bring one little brown piece of envelope. And they say, you put one offering inside here. And it's not so Bible say. Bible say, every time you come, bring an offering. And so. That's why God has got a lot of lame sacrifices. And he don't want it. Keep it! Keep it! He doesn't want it. It's long time people have been abusing God and questioning God. Where? God said, you read this, read the book of Malachi. God says to Israel, you have robbed me here. When have we robbed thee? When have we robbed thee? God said, you have robbed me. And the people, when have we robbed thee? But God said, you have robbed me in tithes and offerings. Bring all the tithe. So it's a long time. People have been shortchanging God. Giving God that which they could not give. Let me tell you something. There's a little place they have in Jamaica called Courthouse. Because the whole world changed, a lot of things changed. Is it 40, 50 years ago? You are going to Courthouse. As a woman, you better wear a hat. If you don't have one, borrow one, beg one. But you got to go into Courthouse with your head covered. All you men, you are going to, just, even if you don't have any case in court, even if you don't have any case in court and you're going to court, you better get a jacket. So for me, as a little boy, I knew some people who they don't go to church. And I know that they are going to court. Some of them, because they have jacket. And when they put on that jacket, about three of them could hold in it. It's borrowed, they borrow it. But you cannot go to court without the jacket if you're a man. I'm telling you something. And when you go to court, and you look on that person, you don't know if it's a JP or a resident magistrate. You have to say, Mirano, Mirano. You can't kimbo. Put your hand in your pocket. You got to stand a certain way and address. And I want to tell you something. You see, when you come to church, those who can kneel, kneel. Those who can't kneel, don't kneel. Those who can stand up, stand. Those who can't stand up, stand up. And some people, and you go to court, you have to stand up. But they come to church and they're, thank you, God. My knee pain, man, my knee. But you go to, your whole body could pain you, better stand up and stand up straight. This is it. Some of us don't give God the best. It's long time this thing is happening. Then sometimes when it come time to sing and pray, a brother or a sister just get the baby and put him in your lap. And just sit down with the baby in your lap. Baby's in my lap. I don't want to stand up. So there are some things we give to God, some attitude we bring into the house of God that we can't take that to courthouse. You can't behave like that. Somewhere we talk in church, you can't talk to policemen like that. Him lock you up. That's why people say, you know, when you certain people walk certain way, they say you walk like you're going to church. Because you have to walk fast to go to your work. You have to walk fast to go to church. But you can't walk any way to church. We have to change that mindset. If God is worthy to be praised. So now 400, just some 400 years after Malachi spoke, the master teacher came on this spot. And the master teacher came on spot. And the master said, you know, I'm anointed. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me for certain needs to be done in the community. To preach the gospel to the poor. Because the gospel was not being given to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. To preach deliverance to the captives. Recovering of sight to the blind. To set at liberty those who are bruised. To preach the acceptable year of the Lord. That's what I'm anointed to do. And I say to you today, church, every disciple of Jesus is called to do that. Every disciple of Jesus is called to be a community leader. Because if you are a follower of Christ, listen, one great thing that every leader has is influence. If you've got influence, you've got a genuine trait of a leader, if you have influence. Make a difference. Lead. And so Jesus said, I'm anointed to serve the need of the society. And this is what the society needs. And the society here still needs this. Maypen needs. Listen, we can go on like, you know, brethren. A lot of us go on like, too much go on like, go on in church. Too much go on like, go on in families. I was telling my students on the topic of looking at the life and the teachings of Christ, and said, some of us would never, ever put in our biography, or want to be put in our biography, certain people in our family. There was a woman called Tamar, not a very wholesome living lady, because she kind of prostituted herself. And then there was another one called Rahab. Every time her name is mentioned in the Bible, it was Rahab the harlot. A lot of us wouldn't want to necessarily know that she's our relative or related to her. And next one was Ruth. Now Ruth came from a background. Her great, great, ever so great grandfather was the father of her mother. The Moabite. We wouldn't want to associate. All of us have skeletons in the closet. All of our families, go check your family roots, your ancestry. All of us have some old thief, some old murderer, some old, all of us. Listen, even Bathsheba, in the lineage of Jesus, Jesus says, listen, I come to deal with some of these issues. I come to deal with the issues of life. And community leaders need to help deal with issues of life. A lot of you, I don't know about you, but I will talk for myself. I don't know one blessed thing about you. I just come here this morning, I know nothing about you. But I might be right if I say a number of people in Jamaica never had a home life. Never had a good home life. Some of you, as a your mother never even give you a kiss and put you to bed. Some of you never even heard your parents look on you and say, "I love you." I'm telling you the truth. That, listen, some of us, the only time we feel our parents' hand is when they box you. I'm telling you something. Some of us grow up rough, you know. Especially if your father did leave your mother and you resemble your father. I'm sorry for you. Broken. Some of us, our parents never even love us. We live in a real broken society. And we live where some people's minds are just set, you are good for nothing. Your mother tell you, your father tell you, everybody tell you, you are good for nothing. And inside your mind, it's not even released by your good. And being a human, there's nothing wrong in being a human. There's nothing wrong in being a black man. I have to tell myself, there is not, if there is one set of people that God loves, is a black man. You read it. When last have you ever seen a white earth? Dirt is black. The best dirt is black dirt. Rich in humus, from which you must have got that word human. So the blacker, the better. Let me tell you something. And if you should really search out your history well, you're going to find that Africa has a sacred place in the heart of God. Where the black man come from has a very affectionate part in the heart of God. Go and check it. Iraq and Iran and Africa. Well, there is where Abraham came from, black man country. Iraq. And when God wanted to preserve his people, Abraham was saved from famine in Africa. Isaac was saved from famine through Africa. Jacob and all his children were saved from famine through Africa. Jesus himself was saved from the death by Herod through Africa. And when Jesus was going to the cross, it was an African who carried his cross. I don't care who don't like. I said, God loves the black man. Has a special part in the heart of God. Don't despise that black man. But you must know the needs. And when Jesus set up, called his disciples in Matthew chapter 10, verse 8. Let me read what he said. And I'm asking the community leaders, I'm asking us as community leaders to start the work. These 12 Jesus sent forth, Matthew chapter 10, verse 5, and commanded them, saying, go not in the way of the Gentiles and into any city of the Samaritans, enter ye not. I wonder if churches understand. Don't go first evangelizing outside there, may I put it that way, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I want you to get this point I'm saying now. Don't hold any big crusade outside there. Start at home. Learn to dance at home. I would to God that the church would learn to dance at home. Because there are a lot of us, you know, we can go and we can preach in Australia. And we can preach in New Zealand. But you can't preach a word in your own house. Your children, them won't listen to you. And your wife will say, you lie. But I can leave here now and go to England and preach. Jesus says now, start it at home. Start it at home. And he says no. And he says, what work you must? He says, heal the sick. Cleanse the lepers. Raise the dead. Cast out devils. That's the work we must begin. As leaders, start at home. Heal the sick. Cleanse the leper. Raise the dead. Cast out the... I like this. When I turn over to the book of St. Mark, chapter 5, it says... And they, Jesus and his disciples, came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. Unclean spirit, that's demonic spirit. Unclean spirit is demonic spirit. And let me tell you something. Let me tell the church, beginning from myself. Any spirit that is not the spirit of God is an unclean spirit.
Any spirit that is not the spirit of God is an unclean spirit, and we must start to cast out unclean spirit from in our house. Too much malice, bad mind, unforgiveness, inability to reconcile differences. Scandalizing, backbiting, gossiping. There are some of us who believe that these, that is the problem I have with church in a bit. The problem I have with church. Because, you see me now, if this church, if some church members heard that there was a gentleman, or a man and I have certain kind of transaction, I couldn't come here and preach you. I couldn't come here and preach you. You must be mad. I hear that I have girlfriend in Maypen, and I have girlfriend in Poor Four Parts, and I have girlfriend. I couldn't come up here and preach. But the church board would block it, block it. Can't come here. He's LGBTQMOPNQRSTUVXYZ. Can't come here. Cannot come here to preach. You understand? But when you read it in the book, Education, Ellen White says, when we gossip, when we scandalize, when we defame a person's character, it is murder. It is just as what the Bible said in Romans chapter 1 of those who died before, died in the deluge. But I can come to church, put on my three-piece suit and thing, with my hypocrisy here, and preach. I went here. Preach. I can wear up my three-piece suit and thing and come up here and sing, "Great is thy faithfulness," with malice and corruption in my life. Let me tell you something. The farthest, the nearest you're going to heaven is church. Nearest you go, all of us. No, not that you, me. Let me start. The nearest I'm going to is church. Until the power of God will drive out the demon. Start it for me. Start it in your house. I like how Ellen White puts it in the book Adventist Home. She says to the husbands, you want to be a saint in heaven, you got to be a saint in your family first. You want to go to heaven, you got to begin to walk and talk heaven now. And why did Jesus say, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils? Because in the kingdom of God, you know, look at four categories of Jesus's miracles. One, he calmed the winds and the waves. Because in the kingdom, nature won't be that vicious and out of place. One, nature won't be irregular and unruly. And he showed that he is. Two, he cleansed all those who are diseases by faith. Because in the kingdom, diseases won't exist. How many are gone now? What was the first one I said again? Eh?
Yeah, nature. And the second one was that again? Yeah, this is the third one now. Cast out devils, because demonic spirits will not be a part of his kingdom. He raised the dead, because there will be no death in the kingdom. And we have to begin that same thing. And I want to tell you that when I read what Ellen White says, she says to the same degree of that it will take to raise a literal dead, to that same degree, the power is needed to transform a carnal man to a spiritual man. Church has to be a spiritual church. Raise the dead. Cast out devils. And it must begin in me. Listen, I felt so bad. I don't remember what I was searching on the internet. And I found that a certain university had some students to go and study, do research on reconciliation. And you know who they sent these students to? They sent these students to the late Nelson Mandela. Not the Pope, not the cardinals, not the bishops, not the leader of the Adventist Church, Nelson Mandela, so that he could tell them, perhaps if Gandhi were alive, they would send to Gandhi, so that he would teach them how to forgive and reconcile the man, the leave the church. Listen. And yesterday, as I was surfing, I found that there was a certain university in the United States that said that things are getting so out of control. That university has now set up what they call an institute of kindness. An institute for kindness. Because kindness has gone awry. Morality is at a low. I say it should be the church that has that institute of kindness. Because some of us rough in a burden. Then stop making the crocus know, but I say you're still rough like crocus. Some of us still rough like crocus. I want to go to heaven. To do what? To do what? You are salt. We are light. If you're not shining, you are not light. If you don't have saltiness, you are not salt. You are dirt. You are stone. Fit. Fit for NAA to use as marl. Fill pothole if we don't have that saltiness. So I'm going to sit down now. What do you say about that church? Say amen if you want me to sit down. Well, you're not saying amen, so I'm not sitting down. Give me a next hour. And this community service is not a one-year event. An event we have once a year. It is said of Jesus that he went forth doing good every day. Every day is an everyday thing that we must have. You know, there was a time in the Adventist church here in Jamaica. I don't know what is happening here, you know, but after Sabbath school class, they used to have a time when they Or was those home missionary? Your one is some kind of funny name. But and the home missionary leader then? You call it, they call it the activities, I think they change it to personal ministries, whatever. Would write up some, ask the brethren, how many people you help? How have you helped? And so on. And I tell you, see, that time, I must tell you something, you know. There was a point in Jamaica where there were 18 churches to be dedicated within 1 month, you know. It's so Adventist, you so hot. But that is in the 1940s. Adventist, you so hot. Because Adventists used to do what we call missionary work. It's not missionary work. Community service work. Community service work. Food basket given away. Articles of clothing. And the church was training its members, all the members, to not look to themselves, but to go and give and give and give and give and give and give. Heal the sick. Cleanse the leper, raise the dead, feed the poor, clothe the naked. And some brethren in the church have to, that is the time when all the members of the church used to walk. After they begin to drive, no. Come and say, I don't feel good asking these questions. And I have my guests and I have my visitors here. I don't feel good. So. And let me tell you something, the people who don't feel good are the people who do nothing. You understand? The people who quarrel about tithe and those things are the people who don't give any tithe. So, the people who are not coming to church work are the ones quarreling. I mean, church work, they. But those who come don't quarrel. Listen. Now, how did I reach that part and that part? How did I reach that part now? What was I saying to reach that part now? What was I saying to reach that part? And the church used to be people who do good work. Right now. A sister wants to help out there. I'm going to send you to the darkest. I'm going to send you to the welfare society. Everything is institutionalized now. Everything. I want to help. I'm going to send you to so-and-so. Who's the welfare department leader? I'm going to send you to... Who is the... okay, man. And a brother come up and I would like a dollar. Okay. I will send you to the pastor. It's not so this thing go. All of us. Not sending anybody to anybody. All of us. That is what the apostle said. That some people say, you know, the Lord will take care of you. Lord, let me pray for you. You want money, don't want no price. You want food, don't want a price. You need clothes, but you got to pray for them. Pray for what? But it's how we behave. That's how we behave. Let me tell you something. Jesus went about doing good. And we ought to go about doing good. Leave them with something else. Peter, because money is not all, you know. One day, Peter and John were going up, and this man sat down. You must know what people need, not what they want. There's a difference between need and want. And Peter and John going up, and this man knows the best place to find, get money. Some people know the best place to find money. They go to the bank. But they never have any bank. It's a temple. And the man sat down and he's looking. And Peter said, listen, I know what you want. I know what you want. But your need is greater than your wants. So I'm not giving you what. He said, what you want, I don't have. Silver and gold, I don't have. Listen, if you're broke like me, brethren, it's not a shame not to have silver and gold. I don't even have zinc, much more silver and gold.
Silver, he said, but what I have, I'm going to give to you. Christians, it's time that we have something that the world needs and we can give it to them. What do you say about that? So, such I have, I'll give that to you. So you hear what I'm saying. I cut off a third of the thing and I'm coming down to grave, you know. As a community leader, as a church member, as a disciple. And you're going to give. You have to, listen, when you're giving to God now, you know, you have to give with an attitude. Hear me now, you have to give with an attitude. Not grudgingly. Not of necessity. Because if you're giving to God, you have to give it smiling. God loves what kind of giver? And you're not giving it so that you can get Governor General's award. What the right hand does, the left hand does. You're not doing it for it to be published in the Central Jamaica Weekly. You're doing it unto God. Whatever you're doing, you have. Listen, read it in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 8. He said, whatever you're doing, you must do it as if you're doing it to God. You people don't even understand. Let me tell you something. There was a time I loved a girl in my town. I don't say the girl loved me, not. I'm not saying the girl loved me because she didn't even know. But only one person knew I loved that girl, and was my brother. And you know, when you love somebody, you can't keep it to yourself. You have to tell somebody. What is that about that? Even if it's the wrong person, you have to tell the person. So I told it to the wrong person. But you see me, man? When I am to go downtown, I dress up in a certain way that if she looks at me, if I see her or if she sees me, I'm going to look a certain way. I picked up a certain attitude. Let me tell you something. A lot of us have given things that we have said we have given to God. And God said, I don't get one blessed thing from you. Because we never give it with an attitude. We have to be cheerful givers. One. He says, when you give, it must be good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. So when you're doing something, it's not half and half, half and half. God, listen. And when you're giving it, anything you're giving, if it is not wrapped up in love, keep it, brethren. Keep it. Because everything God gives is wrapped up in love. For God so what? Oh, yeah. That you what? Listen to me. If you're not giving it with love, keep it. No blessing is in it. If you're coming up here to sing and you're not singing it with love, shut your mouth like some of the brethren down in the church. Yes, have your lockjaw. Listen, give it with love. Do it as unto the Lord. Good measure. You got to give it with an attitude. That's how it will be acceptable. That's how Jesus left it. He said, if I being your master, listen, if I being your Lord and master, this is what I do. He said, you must do the same. You must do the same. This is how I do it. He says, follow me. He says, come follow me. It's time the church gets a certain kind of attitude and disposition and way of doing things. that this world is astonished of what is done and what you do. For too long, men have been giving God any and anything. He doesn't want it that way. So he sent Jesus to show us what is acceptable. And he says, whatever you're going to do, do it with love. It is not an annual event. Do it every day. And you're going to start that work, start it inside of you. Start it with your family. Cast out the devil. Cleanse the leper. Heal the broken heart. Preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Live it, and then you give it. What do you say about that? Live it, and then you give it. And listen. A lady came to the sanctuary of the temple one day, and she had, you know, a whole bank account. She withdrew it 2 mites, and she gave all she had. At one point I said, Jesus, you're tough. Because if I were Jesus and I stood there, Elder Pretty, if I were Jesus at the temple and I stood there and I saw this widow come with only 2 mites to give, I would just work a miracle. When she looked, she said, money she can't count. And I thought that Jesus was not so nice to allow the lady to drop the whole of it. Well, if she drop it, same time, her skirt would be falling off because of money. And Jesus never said that. Jesus said, you see that woman who gave her 2 mites? She gave all she had. All she had. And let me tell you something, brethren. God doesn't want anything less than all from you or from me. He wants nothing but all from you. And if you're not giving him all, keep it. Because he wants all or none at all. And today I want to say to Jesus, I want to give you my all. All to Jesus. I want to surrender. Keep nothing back from you. Everything I own, everything I am, everything I will be, I want it to be for all for you. And I want to make my pledge to Jesus today. Do I have someone else who wants to follow the master teacher? He gave his all for us. And we will also return our all to him. And you want to raise a hand to say, all to Jesus, I surrender. Let the devil see that you are captured by Jesus today. Father, accept the raising of our hands and our hearts to you. Thank you for giving us your all. And we want to reciprocate today to return ourselves, though we don't even belong to ourselves, to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Let us stand and turn our hymnals, open our devices to Hymn 309, I Surrender All. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Our loving Father in heaven, today we surrender all to you. Help us, Lord, to give to you what is right and not what is left. We pray, Lord, that we may never be the same after listening to your words today. We ask you, Lord, to remind us that every good thing comes from you. And we are being asked to give only what you desire of us, which is our all. Let us, Lord, be the full sacrifice and not partial. Let us accept your word in our life. Because you, Lord, gave everything you had. You gave your son, Jesus Christ, so that this world would have an opportunity to be saved. And so, Lord, continue to bless your people and grant us your peace as we leave the presence of the sanctuary today. Let us not leave you out of our lives. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Great blessings we pray.